Now that we know how the trig functions are defined, we're going to find some equations that give us relationships amongst the trig functions, and those are called identities. And we'll start off with what are called the reciprocal identities. So first of all, it's true that cosecant of theta is equal to 1 over sine theta. And the reason that's true, you can check that out, right? Because we know that cosecant of theta, by definition, is r over y, but then sine of theta is y over r, right? So I can clearly see that cosecant is simply the reciprocal of sine, and that's all this is saying, right? If I take cosecant, that's simply equal to 1 over sine. And likewise, that's true for secant, right? Secant of theta is the same thing as 1 over cosine theta, and likewise, cotangent theta is equal to 1 over tangent theta. So these identities are called the reciprocal identities. Okay, a couple more important identities. Tangent is often written in the following way: sine divided by cosine. And that's true because sine is y over r and cosine is x over r, and so the r's will cancel and you'll just get y over x, which is tangent. Likewise, cotangent of theta, that's equal to cosine of theta divided by sine of theta. These identities are called the quotient identities. So all five of these identities get used fairly frequently. The reciprocal identities get used quite often. Like somebody might ask us to find, for example, let's say you have cosecant of 2 pi over 3. Well, cosecant is pretty hard to think about. So what people usually do is say, oh, cosecant of any angle is the same as 1 over sine of that angle, right? So 1 over sine of 2 pi over 3. Now, sine of 2 pi over 3 is root 3 over 2. So this is equal to 1 over root 3 over 2. Now, when you have a number divided by a fraction, that's the same as the number times the reciprocal, right? So 1 times 2 over root 3, which is 2 over root 3. Now, if I rationalize that denominator by multiplying top and bottom by the square root of 3, I end up getting, for my answer, 2 root 3 divided by 3. So the point of this example is that people prefer to think about sine rather than cosecant, and you can just make use of this identity to do that. Now there are a few more identities that are important as well, and those are called the Pythagorean identities. Let's look at those now. So we remember that that if you have an angle and this point has coordinates x, y, we know that cosine of the angle is by definition, well, let's say the radius is r. Cosine is x divided by r, right? And likewise, sine is, well, y divided by r. So if I take these equations and I multiply both sides by r, I get x is equal to r cosine theta, and likewise, y is equal to r sine theta. Okay, now it's also true that from algebra, we can find the equation of this circle. And that equation, using the Pythagorean theorem, you can show that it's equal to this. It's equal to x squared plus y squared is equal to r squared. Now, x and y are represented trigonometrically up here, right? So I'm going to replace that x with r cosine theta. So let's write that over here. It's going to be r cosine of theta quantity squared plus r sine theta quantity squared is equal to r squared. So now this is r times cosine theta, so I'm going to square both of those. Now people don't write, we never write this, right? Nobody writes cosine of theta whole thing squared. What we write instead is this, cosine squared theta. So even though these mean the same thing, this is the more conventional way of writing that idea. So here, this is going to give me, let's write it over here, r squared, okay, then times the square of cosine squared, plus, and the next one's going to be r squared times the square of sine, and that's equal to r squared. Now these have an r squared in common, let's factor that out. R squared times cosine squared theta plus sine squared theta is equal to r squared. And now we'll divide both sides by r squared. And the r squareds are going to cancel. And now this is usually written in the following way. We usually write it as sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta is equal to, and r squared over r squared is equal to 1. This identity right here, this equation, it's true no matter what the angle is. This is called the Pythagorean identity. It's probably the most important identity in trig. It gets used all the time. Now, if you take that identity and you divide both sides by the square of cosine, we can get another identity. So sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta equals 1. Let's divide both sides by the square of cosine. Well, because it's addition, that square of cosine is going to go into both of those. And what is sine squared divided by cosine squared? Well, that's going to be the square of tangent. And then plus cosine squared over cosine squared is 1 is equal to secant squared, because 1 over cosine squared is just secant squared. So this is a Pythagorean identity as well, but it simply involves tangent and secant instead of sine and cosine. Okay, so now if we finally take that Pythagorean identity once more and we divide both sides not by cosine squared but by sine squared, let's see, imagine this was sine squared, right? You're going to get 1 plus cotangent squared, and then 1 over sine squared would be cosecant squared. Okay, so this is another version of, yet another version of the Pythagorean identity. Now the question is, you know, which of these do you want? And you want whichever one is useful in the problem you're working on. This one gets used all the time. This one gets used fairly often. And then the third one gets used every now and then. So let's see some examples making use of these identities. Okay, let's factor and simplify. So I see that this expression, both of these terms have a tangent squared. So I'm going to factor that out of both of them. So this is going to be tan squared times, well, it's going to be 1 minus sine squared. Right? I just factored a tangent squared out of both of those. Now, looking at what's in parentheses, remember that sine squared plus cosine squared is equal to 1, right? So if I subtract sine squared from both sides, I get this. Cosine squared x is 1 minus sine squared. So I can see that 1 minus sine squared, according to this, is equal to cosine squared. So this ends up being tangent squared times cosine squared. Do you see that? All the 1 minus sine squared get replaced with just cosine squared. Now we can go further because tangent squared is sine squared divided by cosine squared. And I still have times cosine squared x. Let's write it over 1. Now the cosine squareds cancel and we have just sine squared, and that would be our answer. Okay, let's try another one. So we have sine x minus cosine x whole quantity squared. Now remember, when you square something, it's basically the quantity multiplied by itself. So we can write this out as sine x minus cosine x times itself. And now when we multiply this out, we have to multiply sine x by both of these, right? And then negative cosine x by both of those as well. So we're going to get, well, it's going to be sine times sine, which is sine squared, and then minus sine x cosine x. And now multiplying these two together, we get another negative sine x cosine x. And then finally, negative cosine times negative cosine is positive square of cosine. Okay, now we can simplify. Do you see the simplification that's about to occur? Well, what is sine squared plus cosine squared? That's just according to identity, our Pythagorean identity, that's equal to 1, right? So sine squared added to cosine squared x is just 1. And then I still have the minus, well, these are like terms, and I have two of those. So sine x, cosine x, and that would be my answer. Okay, let's try some more examples like this. Let's simplify 1 minus cosine squared over secant squared x minus 1. Now you may look at that numerator and say, oh, that's just sine squared, and that's true. But remember, secant is 1 over cosine. And because I have a cosine here, maybe I can have some simplification occurring there. So let's leave that numerator alone for the moment. That's an equality sign. So equals 1 minus the square of cosine divided by, okay, now secant squared is 1 over the square of cosine, right? And then minus 1. Now you might be saying to yourself, well, you just made that more complicated. And that's true. That does look a little more complicated, but what I'm going to now do is I'm going to clear that fraction. And so I have a fraction within a fraction. And so to clear this, I'm going to multiply top and bottom by the square of cosine. So this is a strategy from algebra, clearing or simplifying what are called complex fractions. Okay, so now I'm going to leave that numerator factored, and you'll see why we do that in a moment. So it's 1 minus cosine squared times cosine squared. And that denominator, because it's subtraction right here, we're going to take that cosine squared and distribute. And when we do so, first of all, the cosine squareds are going to cancel, so we're going to get just 1 minus, and then cosine squared x times 1 is just cosine squared x. And now you can see why I left that numerator factored, right? Because it's multiplication here, now 1 minus cosine squared cancels completely with 1 minus cosine squared. And I get, just as my final answer, cosine squared x. Okay, let's try another one. Here we're asked to add or subtract and simplify. Now, whenever you add or subtract expressions, you want a common denominator. So let's write this as tangent of x divided by 1. So I'll multiply top and bottom of this by tangent to get the common denominator. So tangent, right, for the numerator, and a tangent for the denominator. So the numerator becomes, well, tangent squared, right? And then minus secant squared. And I combined those because now the numerators are the same, right? Tangent x times 1 and tangent x. So that common denominator is just tangent x. Now, have you seen an identity before that involves the square of tangent and the square of secant? Sure, right? One of the Pythagorean identities said this, that 1 plus the square of tangent was equal to the square of secant. And so if you subtract secant squared from both sides and subtract 1 from both sides, you're going to get this. Tan squared x take away secant squared x is equal to negative 1. Do you see that? Subtracted secant squared x from both sides, and I subtracted 1 from both sides. So why did I do that? Because that is equal to that whole numerator, right? Tan squared x minus secant squared x. According to this, that's just equal to negative 1. So this is negative 1 divided by tangent x. And finally, we can use the reciprocal identity and write this as negative cotangent x, because 1 over tangent x is cotangent x, and that would be considered our simplified version. Okay, so now we understand, or we've seen how to make use of some of the fundamental identities, and these are going to be really important it's going to be comfortable or important for us later on to be comfortable with these when we are establishing identities. Okay, until next time.